Welcome to Re'eh Yisrael, which means in English, Behold, O Israel, the Bible-teaching television ministry of Congregation Shema Yisrael. Shema Yisrael is a Messianic Jewish congregation in Rochester, New York. Be sure to get out your Bible and a notebook and follow along with this week's lesson from the Scriptures.
I'm your last, O Jerusalem, I have set watch.
For this community, there's very strong resistance to intermarriage, to somebody marrying somebody who's not Jewish. So this is a story about something like that. And I in no way mean to insult any other ethnic group, because this would be true of any ethnic group that a Jewish child thought he might want to marry into. So Moshe was an Orthodox yeshiva boy, born and raised in Brooklyn his entire life. But he got a full scholarship to the University of Montana. And it was such a generous deal that his parents, who would prefer to keep him in Brooklyn forever, decided to let him go. 6 months went by, and his parents did not hear from him. They were frantic. They called the dorm. They were told he didn't live there anymore. They called the registrar, who said he was no longer enrolled. And they were about to fly to Montana when a letter came from Moshe. Dear mother, dear father, sorry I have been negligent, but I met the most wonderful girl, and we plan to marry. That's why I dropped out of school. Little Feather is a Native American, a princess, and her father is the chief of her tribe. He's made me a member of the tribe. I had to leave school because of the nonsense they teach about Native Americans, the lack of respect, the distortions of history. But now I understand things better, and I have decided to take a Native American name, which the chief helped me decide on. From now on, please call me Running Deer. I will not answer correspondence addressed to Moshe. A few days later, he got a reply. Dear Running Deer, your dad and I are pleased that you finally found a woman to love and that you are happy being part of your new tribe. We regret that she's not Jewish, but to celebrate your new love and upcoming marriage, we also have decided to take Native American names. I am now to be called King Shiva. And your father is going to be called Going Meshuggah. Okay. So, I believe everyone here has probably given or received a gift in the last few weeks. Is that right? Everybody has done that. But you know, sometimes we want to give gifts to God. And as soon as I say that, everybody thinks of money, giving money. But, you know, we can also give our time, our energy, our creativity, our abilities. And if you think about it just for a moment, you realize that those things are of greater value to God and to his kingdom and for advancing his kingdom than any money we can possibly give. So when you made Yeshua, the Lord of your life, what did it mean? Well, it meant you were making him the boss in charge of your life. It meant that you were committing yourself to serve him. And this week's Parsha is the conclusion of the account of the man who is the reason we bless the children, Joseph. And he's an amazing character. How many have read the story of Joseph in the Bible? Amazing, amazing character. The Bible records no fault in him, only exemplary behavior. And he is the second greatest example in the Bible of a great servant, somebody who gave himself to the Lord. And his example of his ability to be an exemplary servant in the midst of great adversity is just a tremendous example. And, of course, he ended up saving the people of Israel and much of the world from a terrible famine. So if you've noticed, every week during announcements, Ethel or whoever is making the announcements, we're asking people to step up and serve. And so because this week's Parsha was about the second greatest servant in the Bible, And we've been saying that over and over again. The Holy Spirit was very much saying, you need to talk about servanthood today. So I mentioned the second greatest example of a servant in the Bible. Who's the greatest example? Obviously, Yeshua. So let's look at what he said about being a servant. In Matthew chapter 20, Yeshua was correcting his disciples about their attitude about wanting to rule over each other. They were talking about who would be the greatest. And here's what he said. But Yeshua called them and said, you know that among the goyim, among the Gentiles, amongst the non-believers, those who are supposed to rule them become tyrants, and their superiors become dictators. And boy, haven't we seen that in the world, all right? Verse 26, among you, it must not be like that. On the contrary, whoever among you wants to be a leader, or in other translations, wants to be great among you, must become your, let's say it together, servant. This is one of those upside down principles of the kingdom of God. Verse 27, and whoever wants to be first must be your slave. For the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. So he was the model of servanthood. And he served us in the ultimate way of serving, by giving his life so that by receiving him, we could become children of God. So we're going to dig into this a little bit. First of all, what does Yeshua mean by being great among you? If you wanted to be great, doesn't that seem like you're egotistical and conceited and prideful? Well, no, it means to be the best disciple, to be most pleasing to God, to be fruitful in this context. So how many of you want to be great among the people of God in that context? I should think all of you. No? No? Anybody not want to be great among the kingdom of God, people of God, in the proper sense that God wants you to be? So if we truly want to be great in his kingdom, we need to look carefully at these words, at the way which we understand the meaning of these words, like the two phrases up there, your servant and your slave. Now, I think everybody would probably come to your mind immediately in Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 20. It says this, Adonai, the Lord your God, you will fear. Him you will serve. To him you will cling, and by his name you will swear. So the Bible obviously teaches us to serve God, right? But note that Yeshua doesn't say that. Who did he tell us to serve? One another. Not just the Lord, who we are supposed to serve, but he said you're supposed to be your servant and your slaves. Your refers to other people. So we are to serve other people if we want to serve God. Now, the word in the Greek is diakonos, that's translated servant, and it's a pretty humbling word. To run errands, be an attendant, like a waiter, or other menial duties. In some places, it's translated as a deacon, because they're supposed to be servants. And the word doulos is subjection, bondservant. Now, I believe that these words are very much misunderstood in our culture, our American culture. First of all, because very few of us actually have the vocation of being servants, right? And probably even fewer of us have servants serving us. So how do we understand this? Also, none of us are slaves, praise God, right? So how do we understand this word servant in the context of which Yeshua was using it? Because that's what is important here. What did he mean by it? Well, in the United States, I think we use it in three ways. We serve people by caring for them, like a nurse would serve a patient. We serve people like jumping in and helping out when we have a chance. And finally, we serve people like we would serve our employer, where we show up for work every day and do what he asks us to do. Now, which one of those did Yeshua mean? What was the context when he used the word servant? Well, it's pretty clear to me in the culture of the Bible, it was based on servants. If you read through the Gospels, it's all about their servants all the time. But the servants were not somebody who just dropped by when they felt like it. They were people who were committed to serving in a specific place. The equivalent of employee in our culture would be a servant in that culture, serving in a committed way. So based on that, to be great in God's kingdom, you must serve other people with devoted service, subjecting yourself, like the word doulos, to those who are in charge, specifically to ones whom God calls to lead in something. Now, the other two ways of serving are great, but I don't believe that's what Yeshua was talking about when he says to be great in the kingdom, you need to be servants. You need to serve each other. Now, many believers, I found this, especially with people who are come new to the congregation, have the attitude that they can serve God in the first two ways, but they avoid committing themselves to serving in some committed, devoted way. So why is this important? Why does God require the serving of people in positions of leadership in the kingdom? Well, there's a couple of reasons. First of all, the way I've seen things play out, God gives vision to people. And usually God gives a vision to a person, it's bigger than they can fulfill by themselves. And so he calls them to cast that vision out, and he calls other people to catch that vision and get on board with that vision and help fulfill that vision. So somebody, usually the person who's got the vision, is going to lead, and other people are going to help fulfill that. Otherwise, we couldn't do anything more than we could do as an individual. We couldn't do anything as a group. So for the kingdom of God to grow and develop and to accomplish its purposes, I think you would all agree with me, people need to serve, right? And actually, that's not just true for the kingdom of God. It's true for every organization. We have that expression, you know, we can't have all chiefs. Some have to be Indians, right? Second reason why serving this way is important, because true service is a prerequisite for leadership in the kingdom of God. Because you can't serve as a leader unless you know how to serve. Okay? And here's another passage that speaks to this in a very clear way. Actually, another one of those amazing upside-down things of the kingdom of God. There was a Roman centurion who had a servant who was deathly sick. And this centurion sent messengers to Yeshua to ask him to heal his servant. And in Luke chapter 7, verse 6, it says this, Yeshua went with them, with the messengers. He'd not gone far from the house when the officer sent friends who said to him, Sir, don't trouble yourself. I'm not worthy to have you come under my roof. Verse 7, this is why I didn't presume to approach you myself. Instead, just give a command and let my servant recover. For I, too, am a man under authority. I have soldiers under me, and I say to this one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes, and to my slave, do this, and he does it. And then verse 9 is amazing. Yeshua was astonished at him when he heard this. And he turned and said to the crowd following him, I tell you, not even in Israel have I found such trust or such faith. And when the messengers got back to the officer's house, they found the servant in good health. So why was Yeshua so astonished at this centurion's trust or faith? It's because of the difference between two little tiny words, under and in. Because back here in verse 8, you would think the centurion, in fact, you might think it was a mistake in the text, for the centurion to say, for I too am a man under authority. You would think he would have said, I too am a man in authority. I tell soldiers to do this and they do it, right? But it doesn't say that. It says, I am a man under authority. So what does he mean, and why is that important for servants in the kingdom of God? Well, the centurion, this is a pretty high position in the Roman army. He had 100 men, centurion, that's what that means, century, 100 men reporting to him. But what he understood, that his authority over those 100 men would not exist unless he was under the authority of the officer over him. They wouldn't do what he told them to do unless he was submitted to the officer who was in charge of him. I don't know what that is. That was a legionnaire or something who was one rank higher. If he had not been serving the officer over him, he wouldn't have had any authority. And that's why he said, I am a man under authority. That's why I can make this command. And here's the spiritual side of this. He understood that Yeshua was under authority. Whose authority was Yeshua under? The Father. And that was why Yeshua had the power over the sickness afflicting his servant. So, here's where this all plays out in relation to us. We must be under God's authority, but also God has created human leadership in his body. Hopefully it's created by God, and a lot of times we see in places where it's not God's authority and God's leadership. But we must be under God's authority, and to be under God's authority, we must be under the human authority that he has put in place. And here's the key, especially for those of you who like to pray or who need to pray, this is a requirement for spiritual power. That's what the centurion is saying here. I know you have this power because you're under authority. So God is a God of order and organization, and he creates an organizational structure, and he says the power flows through that organizational structure. So let me summarize so far what we've seen. God calls us to serve other people in his body. It's supposed to be serving as a devoted servant. Serving is a requirement for leading. A true leader has the attitude of a servant. What do I mean by that? A true leader is serving somebody who is supervising them, but he's also serving the people whom he's leading by providing leadership. Because the scripture says that without a leader, the people, any people, but especially the people of God, are like what? Sheep without a shepherd. So when a person takes it on themselves, the responsibility to see something accomplished, that's leadership. And he's serving by taking that role so that other people will get bored and whatever needed to be accomplished is accomplished. You follow what I'm saying? It's very key to understand that. Now, you might say, well, that's easy for you to say because you don't have anybody that you're submitted to. Well, that's not true. I'm certainly submitted to God, but we could all say we're all submitted to God. But in our governmental structure here, I'm submitted to the elders. And I feel uncomfortable when I'm not submitted to the elders. When, like, we went through a period of time where there was just Carl and I as elders, I'm feeling much more comfortable now because there's five of us. Okay? So I am submitted, but also I would not be serving in this role, and you hear me use that term, of leading this congregation if I didn't see it as serving you. Okay? I'm not here to be served by you. I'm here to serve you by providing teaching, by organizing, by encouraging, by praying, all of those things. So all of that is all upside down to the world, right? Now, here's another thing that people often get confused about this. People are not born great servants. They need to learn how to be good servants. So to help us understand what it takes to be a good servant, let's go back to the Parsha with the story of Joseph and this great servant. Now, let's start with Genesis chapter 39 and verse 1. Now, Joseph had been brought down to Egypt. Potiphar, an official of Pharaoh, commander of the bodyguards, bought him from the hand of the Ishmaelites who had brought him down there. Now, if you don't know the story, Joseph was his father Jacob's favorite son. And he was sold into slavery by his jealous brothers, who almost killed him. Instead, they sold him into slavery. So Joseph was experiencing some very significant adversity here. He was a slave. He had been the favorite son. He's a slave now. He was away from his beloved family. And he would have been greatly tempted, as you or I would have been tempted, to be bitter about this. To be bitter, to be depressed, to be self-pitying, to be angry at his brothers, to be angry at God. Right? But look at verse 2. But Adonai, the Lord, was with Joseph. So he became a successful man in the house of his master, the Egyptian. Now, very easily from this, we can see he was not a bitter man. He was not angry. He was not depressed. He wasn't wallowing in self-pity. Why? Because he was experiencing God's presence. And those iniquities, that list of iniquities, they would have prevented him from getting into God's presence. So how did Joseph overcome the temptation to be in that state of mind of bitterness and anger? Well, he must have been choosing to spend time with God. He must have been spending time in prayer and in worship and have the presence of God in him. Verse 3, his master saw that Adonai was with him and that Adonai made everything he set his hand to successful. Joseph found favor in his eyes, so he served him as a personal servant and he made him an overseer over his household. Everything that was his, he entrusted into his hands, into Joseph's hands. So I hope you can see God's presence was really strong on Joseph, so strong that his master could see it. And his master was not necessarily a believer. He was an Egyptian. They worshiped all kinds of gods. But his master could see this man has the presence of God upon him. Now, I don't think this happened like right away. Joseph was sold to Potiphar. He walked in the house and Potiphar looked at him and said, "Oh my gosh, God's presence is on you. Take over my whole household." I don't think that's the way it happened. I think it happened over slow years of Joseph proving himself to be faithful, to be diligent, to be the best servant. Then verse 5, from the time that he, Potiphar, made Joseph an overseer in his house and over everything that belonged to him, Adonai blessed the Egyptian's house because of Joseph. Adonai's blessing was on everything that belonged to him in the house and in the field. Verse 6, so he, Potiphar, released everything he owned into Joseph's hand. And with him in charge, he did not have to think about anything except the food he ate. Pretty amazing. And again, it didn't happen overnight. This was a great trust. And then we find something very interesting. Now, Joseph was handsome in form and handsome in appearance. And that brought some even greater adversity upon Joseph. Joseph was falsely accused by Potiphar's wife of sexually assaulting him. And Potiphar had to believe her. And so in verse 20, it says this, then Joseph's master took him and put him in prison, the place where the king's prisoners were confined. So there he was in the prison. But Adonai was with Joseph and extended kindness to him and gave him favor in the eyes of the commander of the prison. Adonai was with Joseph again. Another set of adversity. So again, Joseph resisted the temptation to become bitter. It keeps getting worse, but Joseph resists it. How? I can only think it's because he came into God's presence, spent time with the Lord. I don't know how else he could have done this. Verse 22, then we read these amazing, amazing words. The commander of the prison entrusted into Joseph's hand. I'm sorry, verse 21. But Adonai was with Joseph and extended kindness to him and gave him favor in the eyes of the commander of the prison. The commander of the prison, verse 22, entrusted into Joseph's hand all the prisoners who were in the prison so that everything that was done there, he was responsible for it. The commander of the prison did not concern himself with anything at all under his care because Adonai was with him, with Joseph. And Adonai made whatever he did successful. Does that sound familiar? Exactly the same thing that Potiphar did, trusted everything to Joseph. Amazing. The Lord's blessing on Joseph, bringing him to this position of great responsibility, second in command and authority. So did Joseph become this valued by his masters as if by magic? It just happened? I don't think so. I think it happened because God gave Joseph the ability to be a great servant to Potiphar and later to the jailer. Now, we can learn more about what it means to be a good servant by looking at how Potiphar and the jailer felt about Joseph's service. So I'm just going to go back and repeat some of the verses. Verse 6, so he released everything he owned into Joseph's hand. With him in charge, he'd not think about anything except the food he ate. Verse 22, the commander of the prison entrusted into Joseph's hand all the prisoners who were in the prison so that everything that was done there, he was responsible for it. And verse 23, the commander of the prison did not concern himself with anything at all under his care because Adonai was with him and Adonai made whatever he did successful. So you can see that Potiphar and the jailer saw something in Joseph that caused them to promote him and to give him this place of great responsibility. And that's in 39, verse 3 and 23, Adonai was with him and Adonai made everything he set his hand to successful. So what did these two see in Joseph? The Lord was with him. Everything he did prospered. So let's glean a little bit about being a servant here. What enables us to be good servants? The Lord being with us, right? And when that happens, we're supposed to prosper. You see that? I also believe that there was a connection here between Joseph being a servant, having a servant's heart and serving, and him being able to overcome the temptation to be bitter and angry about what had happened to him. He was helped in resisting those temptations by the fact that he threw himself into serving. He embraced being a servant to Potiphar and the jailer, and it gave him purpose and it produced fruit in his life. And those are key ingredients to overcoming adversity. So now I'm going to do something I've done before in this group, but it's been quite a few years. So some of you remember this. If you do, that's fine. But I'm going to ask you the question. Suppose you were in a position of responsibility like Potiphar or like the jailer. Let's say you were a business owner, as some of you are, or the principal of a school, or a government administrator, or a hospital director, or a pastor or a rabbi. What would you look for in a person whom you would be willing to put in charge of all your affairs? Let's say you ran a hospital, and an opportunity, you ran it really well, and an opportunity opened up to go administrate another hospital which was doing poorly and to get it to run right. But you couldn't leave the one you were working in because you had to be there. So what would you do? You'd find somebody who you could trust to take over and lead the one that you were leading and do it the way you would so you could go lead the other one, right? Okay. So what would you look for in that person that you'd be willing to put in charge of your affairs? So in the interest of time, in past times I've asked the people who participate, but I just want to show you a list of when I've done this before, what people came up with. So let's see the next slide there. Willingness and ability to do things the way I want them done. Willingness to receive correction. To do things when we want them done. A can-do spirit rather than, oh no, we can't do that. Seeking my good and not that person's own good. Treating my business as if it were his business. Knowing my heart and sharing my vision. And agreeing with my priorities so that he can make the same decisions I would. Those make sense? Okay, a bunch more. Putting my interests above his own. Not someone who wants to take away my job. Being faithful to complete things, even when they're difficult. Being committed to be my servant no matter what happens. Being willing to stand up for me when others oppose. Trusting me enough, this is a big one, to be willing to tell me the bad news when it's true. Next slide. Somebody who's confident, loyal, someone who's generous, teachable, someone who's grateful, cheerful, grounded, stable, mature, respectful, kind, someone who completes tasks, alert, sees dangers coming, someone who is effective, discreet. Discretion is a great virtue. Someone who is self-motivated, attentive to detail, not careless. Someone who has integrity, honest, kind of the same thing. Someone who is humble, dependable. I think I got a couple more. Faithful. Someone who is open-minded, friendly, and is a team worker. So, you probably can think of a few others. But that's a list. That would be the list of a person who would be a great servant. You agree? That would be great. It's also a description of a person of a healthy relationship between an employer and employee, or a servant and a master. So in every congregation in the body of Messiah, there's a rabbi or a pastor who would love to see a congregation full of people just like that. So here's the challenge. I'm going to ask you to do some introspection. And I know some of you are doing this. Some of you are doing it to some degree. But in your life, who are you serving? Are you serving your spouse? Your boss at work? Who have you served in the kingdom? Here or in some other congregation? Have you served a leader in a congregation or the pastor or the rabbi? And here's the really tough question. Tough question is, what would the person you served say about your service according to the standards we just listed? You can go home and think about that one for a while. But please, don't get under condemnation. And don't get angry at me. Because every time I've shared this, and I've shared this in a few places, and here a couple of times, people have mixed emotions about this. And perhaps some of you are having those mixed emotions right now. You agree. That's what the Word of God says. But somehow you just like bristle inside because, wow, serving other people, that's really not me. You're not alone in that. We have to learn to be good servants. We're not born that way. In fact, serving others goes against our human nature, absolutely the opposite direction, because we automatically look out for who? Number one, right. And most of us, including me, have difficulty with saying, I want to serve in this way, humble myself and serve it this way. So the Holy Spirit has showed me something about us as Americans, about this whole thing, that we have a particular difficulty. And there's two ways that that difficulty has come about. One is, all of us have been through American schools. What does our system of education teach us about how to get ahead and be a success? Perform. Perform better than the next guy, right? Do the best on tests, perform well. Can you recall in your schooling, and maybe if you're younger, they're doing it now, but certainly not when I went to school, you can recall being taught to be a good servant? No. Now, good performance is part of being a good servant, but it doesn't make you a good servant. So now there are some parts of our education system where you do learn to serve others, but it's not in the classroom. It's on the athletic field, right? In the band, no orchestra, in the drama club. Places like that, we have to learn to work as a team and submit to one another and work together. Extracurricular activities. Now, here's the other place where this influences. What kind of influence did other children in our childhood have in making us good servants? Anybody ever heard the word brown nose? Did you ever get called a brown nose or call somebody that? Or apple polisher? Kiss up? Some of you remember those words? What's that all about? Well, if you serve the teacher, whoever's in authority, you're just trying to make them like you so that you'll get ahead of everybody else. See, it all comes back to that getting ahead thing. So in my growing up, I was discouraged from being any kind of a servant to anybody in authority, like teachers or parents or anything, because I would be accused of being an apple polisher or a brown nose. That, can anybody else relate to that? That's the way it was. Now here's a third way thing that is there. In America, we seem to teach this, and I believe it's a stronghold that affects American society. And the power is there because our founders came to this country to be their own bosses, to be independent. And so there's this thing, an independent spirit. Now, it has its good points, the independent spirit. We're very creative, and we stand up for rights. But Americans don't do that well at working together. As teams. I learned this in a very difficult way when I worked for Xerox and we were competing with the Japanese, who are great team players. And they just put us to shame by the way they did things. It was totally not our culture. And we'd go over to Japan on trips to try to learn from them, and we'd see it, and we'd come back, and we'd get all these lectures, and we'd try it, and it still wouldn't work. Everybody would still go around trying to build their own empire. It's the American way. So there's this anti-servant teachings, and here's something that I experienced, is that they help you get through school. Like, I got good grades in high school, and I got to go to a good college, and then I got good grades in college, and I went on to a good graduate school. But what happens when you get out in the world? Now, there are some employment opportunities that are based on performance, like things you take a civil service test for. But I found that most of the world is still based on servanthood. And here's how I found this out. I got through graduate school, taking courses, did really well, but I was going for a PhD. And when you go for a PhD, you have to hook yourself up with a professor and basically serve that professor. You have to get into a mentoring relationship with that professor. And I found that I didn't know how to do that. It was foreign to me. So I failed. I wasn't able to go on with graduate school. And I left graduate school and went out and started to work. And the first several years that I was working, I just focused on performing. And I did okay, but I found I wasn't given any leadership responsibility. That never seemed to happen. And then the Lord got a hold of me on this whole subject and showed me that what I was supposed to be doing was serving my boss. And that was weird to me, serve my boss. And yet, because it was the Word of God, I began to do it. And at the same time, I found that I was part of congregations and I needed to learn to serve pastors and things like that. And that was when I started to get leadership responsibility. And I realized that most of industry works on that principle. Be a servant to your immediate supervisor. He'll promote you when you meet his needs. And when he gets promoted, he'll promote you. And as he gets more responsibility, you'll get more responsibility as you help him manage it. So what I found is I had to unlearn the way I had been raised. So the reality in congregations, and I've talked to many pastors about this, is that in America, there's a very strong resistance to serving in a devoted way in the body. And I can tell you, you guys are all great people. Very few people come to me and say, what can I do to fulfill the vision God has given the leadership here in this congregation? More people come to me and say, oh, the Lord has given me this great vision. Here's what I want to do. And then I'll kind of think about this and pray and say, well, let me see if I can fit that into the vision of the congregation. You see the difference? It's radical difference. And I've gone down some real long rabbit trails that way. And I'm not saying at all that people shouldn't be creative and anointed and enthusiastic. But I'm saying that this is the way God organizes things. God's plan is that we're to use the gifting that he's given us to fulfill the vision that he gives to the congregation. And the leadership's responsibility is to seek the Lord for the congregation's vision, for the direction. Communicate that, organize to fulfill it, but the rest of the people are to be the ones that fulfill it. Now also, we have come to understand over the years that we want to involve people in finding the vision, clarifying the vision also. So, here's a hard saying. If you can't get behind the vision of the leader of the congregation that you're in, whether it's this one or some other, go somewhere else where you can get behind that vision. See, because if we all knew how to serve in the kingdom of God, I believe the kingdom of God would experience revival in an incredible way. It would explode. But we all need to be like Joseph and serve wherever the Lord leads us to serve, responsibly and as well as we can. So how do you start? Well, you can start in your home. Be a servant to each other if you're married. Be a servant to your boss at work. Be a servant to a leader in the congregation. Pray. Now, here's something that's very important. You can't all directly serve your senior pastor or senior rabbi. I would be overwhelmed if all 100 of you here today all said, I want to serve, and you have to be my direct supervisor. I wouldn't be able to do that. So here's an amazing thing. God created middle management. Okay? So there are other people who have to step up to leadership and provide that leadership function. Part of my job is to help you find a place to serve. So what can you do here? Well, we've been saying for weeks, we need more teachers for the children. We need more ushers. We need help in the bookstore. We need help setting up the equipment, as Larry's waving his hand back there, on the soundboard and on the video and on the projection. So we've been encouraging people to serve in those ways for weeks, and I'm believing that the Spirit of God will move on some people to do that. But I also want to share some new initiatives that the Lord has been bringing forth that we want to get off the ground that will require more servants and leaders here. So the first one is something that I've been praying about for a long time and wanting to see. If you see today, when we get to the end of the service And some people will leave very quickly. But if you hang around in this room, do you know what you see? You see a whole bunch of people standing around talking with each other for another 15, 20, 30 minutes sometimes. Okay, so I want to encourage that. I want to encourage that fellowship going on. And I hope that we can get it together to organize, to encourage having what we in Judaism call a kiddush after the service. That's light refreshments upstairs, just like bagels and spreads and coffee and tea, that would be set up upstairs. And so instead of people having to hang out here, they can go upstairs, have a cup of coffee, and sit down for a while and have that time of fellowship together. But we're going to need somebody to coordinate it. We're going to need somebody to set it up, and we're going to need somebody to clean it up. So there you've got probably five or six places that people could serve. Secondly, we're about to start doing Spanish translation. We've ordered the equipment for Spanish translation. And we have a couple of people who are able to translate from English into Spanish. However, they're not here all the time. So we need other people to step up to that translation thing, to do that. Another thing that has come across my mind from the leadership conference I went to, and even from the place Diane and I visited last week, is that I'd like to see us have name tags for all of us, big name tags with your first name on it. And when a visitor comes, give him a name tag with his name tag, name printed on it. And everybody would have these tags. They would stay here. You'd pick them up when you come in the morning. And we'd all be able to know each other's names, because I have a terrible time remembering names. So this is really for great benefit for me. But again, we need somebody who would take that on. It's a significant task. Get the name tags made, make sure that they're returned. And so there's all kinds of things that we can do. But you may have an idea of something that fits in with the vision here. That may be how the Lord brings it. I'm sure there's lots of ideas out there. So we're going to end up here with just one passage that has been really important in my life, and then we're going to pray. Colossians chapter 3, verse 23. Whatever you do, do it heartily, as to the Lord, not to men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the reward of the inheritance, for you serve the Lord, the Messiah. So what does this mean? Well, first of all, the word heartily needs to be clearly understood. It simply means with all your heart, with all your heart, with all your strength, with all your might. And what does as to the Lord mean? Well, that's where this verse just spoke to me so much. That means as I serve, now if I serve somebody else, I need to serve them as if they were the Lord. Whoa, that's a whole different way of looking at it. I need to serve them as they were the Lord themselves, whether it's the serving in the way of helping them out with something, or it's the serving in the way of devoted, committed service to be able to do something. So let's pray that we would be able to be this kind of servant. If you're willing to pray, and then we're going to pray also against that's the stronghold in our culture, which is really a stronghold. So Father, we just thank you for today. And I pray that you would help us to understand in our hearts, deep down in our hearts, that to be great, to be pleasing to you, to be fruitful in your kingdom, we must be godly servants, oh God. And help us to understand also that other principle of being under authority, that you give spiritual power to those who are under your authority and the godly authority that you have established. And so right now, any of us who are willing, Lord God, we humble ourselves to receive this understanding. We humble ourselves to be servants, oh God. We thank you for the example of Yeshua, who laid down his life to serve. We thank you for the example of Joseph, who served in the midst of terrible adversity, being a slave, being a prisoner, being accused, being betrayed by his brothers. We thank you for those examples. And right now, Father, we repent of pride. We repent of being stubborn, of stiff-neckedness, of independence, of rebellion. We repent of having to be in control, having to be right, having to be the boss. We repent of these things, God, and any times we've fallen into them. And we break the power of those spirits over them, spirits of independence arrogance and pride, spirits of stubbornness and stiff-neckedness, rebellion and control. In the name of Yeshua, we break the power of those spirits over us. And now, Father, we ask that you would touch our hearts, because your word speaks of having servants' hearts, and that you would give us servants' hearts, a spirit of servanthood, oh God. Teach us how, Lord, to be great servants, to be servant leaders, Lord. And show us who amongst us we are to serve. How are we to serve each other? And who are we to serve? And how are we to serve in that way? And we just look forward, Father, to seeing your kingdom advance in mighty ways as we step into this in Yeshua's name. Amen and amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Okay.
Stay tuned for a short closing message from Rabbi Jim Appel.
Shalom. I'm Messianic Rabbi Jim Appel, and I hope you enjoyed our TV program. It was produced for you by Congregation Shema Yisrael, a Messianic Jewish synagogue. Shema Yisrael is a congregation of Jewish and non-Jewish people who worship the God of Israel while maintaining our Jewish identity and lifestyle, and who believe that Yeshua, whose English name is Jesus, is Israel's promised Messiah. Shema Yisrael's purposes are to proclaim Yeshua as Messiah to Jewish and non-Jewish people and help them connect personally with the God of Israel through worship. We welcome you to join our mishpacha, or family, and connect with your Jewish roots. I'd love to meet you personally at one of our weekly Shabbat services or at one of our special events where people from all backgrounds are welcome. Shalom.
We hope you enjoyed today's teaching. Call our office to request a copy on videotape. If you would like more information about Messianic Judaism or Shema Yisrael, please call us at 585-288-0670, or you can write us at 1326 North Winton Road, Rochester, New York, 14609, or visit our website at www.shemayisrael.org, where you can find a listing of upcoming special events. Please join us for our weekly Shabbat service, Saturday mornings at 10 a.m. Complete children's program interpretation for the deaf is available. Please notify us in advance if it is needed. We hope you'll visit the featuring Messianic Jewish bookstore located in the lobby of Shema Yisrael. Call for hours. Congregation Shema Yisrael also sponsors Bagels and Blessings, a Messianic music and talk radio program with Ethel Chadwick, Sundays from 2 to 3 p.m. on WRCI 102.7 FM. You can also hear Bagels and Blessings by going to our website, www.shemayisrael.org, or bagelsandblessings.com. Please join us for our Messianic Judaism class, Israeli dance class, Hebrew class, or youth group. Call the office for hours and locations. Tune in next week when Reg A. Yisrael will again bring you teachings from the Scriptures.